So next we have Richard Wolitski, Dr. Richard Wolitski. He's an acting director of the Office of HIV, AIDS, and Infectious Disease Policy at the Department of Health and Human Services. This office is responsible for the developing, coordinating, and supporting the implementation of the Health and Human Services policies, programs, and activities related to HIV, viral hepatitis, and other infectious diseases of public health significance. Dr. Wolitski.
Share with you for a little bit. Okay. Thank you, everybody. So I was asked to be here today to give you a federal government perspective on antiretroviral therapy, treatment as prevention, and PrEP. But I'm sorry, Paul, sorry, Matthew, that's not what I'm gonna do. I'm going to speak from a more personal perspective as a person living with HIV. And I'm doing this in part because today's actually a day that's really significant for me in a very personal way. Today would have been the 52nd birthday of my partner John, who passed away in 1994. He was 29, and he died at a time when, if he just could have held on for another year, another 18 months, he would have been one of the people who was saved when we had the breakthrough in HIV treatment that occurred in the mid-1990s. When we got the new data on protease inhibitors and effective HIV treatments, we acted, we responded. We funded the AIDS Drug Assistance Program. We created PEPFAR. And as a result of us seizing that opportunity, taking that moment and acting, we saved hundreds of thousands of lives in the US and millions of lives around the world. But what I think a lot of people don't realize is that we are at one of those moments again, right here, right now. At the International AIDS Conference in Durban this summer, they presented the follow-up results to HPTN-052. And as part of that, they reported that for persons who were assigned to HIV treatment, after 4 years of follow-up, there was a 93% reduction in HIV transmission. Now, 93% is a lot, but what does that 93% really mean? It means that 93% of people who were given HIV medications, well, there's a reduction of 93% in transmission among the people who got medication. It doesn't mean that there was a 93% reduction among the people who took the medication. It doesn't mean that there was a 93% reduction among the people who took it every day. And it most certainly doesn't mean that there was a 93% reduction among the people who were virally suppressed. Does anybody know how many HIV transmissions there were from persons who were virally suppressed? Zero. To date. From that study and all the other studies, and thousands of person years of follow-up, there is not a single case of HIV being transmitted from somebody who is virally suppressed to a sexual partner. Not a one. This is a game-changing moment in the history of the HIV epidemic. CDC's done some modeling work that has estimated what would happen if we could achieve the goals of the National HIV/AIDS Strategy for Viral Suppression. If we were to achieve those goals, by 2020, we would prevent 165,000 new HIV infections from occurring. And if we scaled up PrEP, even in a modest way, we could prevent 20,000 more new HIV infections. but we're so far away from where we need to be. We know that fewer than half of people living with HIV who've been diagnosed in the United States are virally suppressed. We know that of the 1.2 million people that the CDC estimates could benefit from PrEP, that fewer than 10% of them are receiving PrEP. Why is that? Well, part of the reason is so many people don't have access to health care. But even when we look at people who have access, people in the Ryan White program, for example, we see that everybody is not benefiting equally. When we look at viral suppression rates, we see that young people, trans women, African Americans, Latinos, Native Americans, homeless persons, all are faring worse. And when we talk about why is that, so often we go to a place that focuses on the person living with HIV. We talk about, oh, well, they've got lots of challenges, mental health, substance use, poverty. Even when we're well-intentioned, where do we go? We typically go to the person. We don't go to the healthcare system. We don't say that the healthcare system is failing the person living with HIV. We go to the person. And when we think about who is the healthcare system set up to work for, the healthcare system is set up 9 out of 10 times so that it's easy for the provider, that it's meeting the needs of the insurer and the payer, and us, as the people living with HIV, we have to jump through all sorts of hoops to get our appointments. When we get them, we have to sit in the waiting room, sometimes for hours, and then when we need to get our prescriptions refilled and we need to get our medications paid for, it's more and more hoops to jump through. We are at a critical moment in history, and we need to demand that the systems that are designed to serve us are meeting our needs, and that we are getting the results that we have paid for as taxpayers. Now, when I talk about us being at this moment in history and talk about the data and talk about the infections that can be prevented, we talk about survival and reduction in deaths among people living with HIV as a result of viral suppression, we also have to spend a moment to acknowledge what this really means to the lives of people living with HIV. I think I'm a pretty well-evolved person living with HIV, a pretty privileged person living with HIV, but I have to be honest, I still hold a little bit of that stigma inside of me. I still have that fear that I could have accidentally transmitted HIV to someone that I loved. These new data, hearing Dr. Carl Diefenbach, for example, from the NIH say that someone who is undetectable is not infectious and has a negligible risk of transmitting HIV to a sexual partner lifts a huge burden off of my shoulders. And in conversations that I've had with a lot of people here at USCA, and from hearing other people like Jeremiah Johnson from TAG, Bruce Richmond from PIC talk about these issues, this is real. This is affecting our lives, how we see ourselves, and how the rest of the world sees us. Think about what this means for stigma if someone who's undetectable cannot transmit HIV. Are we a threat? Are we something to be feared? No. We are not dirty. We are not a threat. And we are not disease vectors. In fact, we are the solution. People living with HIV who achieve viral suppression, who become undetectable are the solution to the end of new HIV infections in the United States. We have to be clear about that power that we have. We have to hold our providers and the healthcare system accountable for delivering the results that our lives depend on. And we have to lift each other up and support those who are facing challenges to achieving viral suppression. We are at a unique moment in history, and I believe that when we look back 20 years from now, we're going to judge ourselves in terms of how well we responded to this opportunity and whether we acted and did the things that were needed to create the systems change and to get rid of the baggage from the earlier years of the epidemic and to really realize that we have the power to end new HIV infections and to end stigma, not only here, but around the world. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wolitski. I do have one question for you. One of the things that you talked about is the fact that treatment as prevention, that individuals that are HIV positive being virally suppressed, that we have the ability to end this epidemic. There's a lot of argument that individuals that are HIV positive, it's thought of as giving permission to have condomless sex. And so there has been a stigma created in that in and of itself. Can you speak on the efforts to make this a national campaign to educate everyone about what it means to be virally suppressed and trying to take away the stigma on an overall level, on a national level, to look at HIV differently?
I feel like we're at that tipping point at this very moment, and I feel like people are coming together to give voice to these data and, quite frankly, to kind of process them on a personal level in terms of what they mean for themselves and the choices that they're making. I think, you know, these data have been accumulating slowly over time, and really was in Durban where I think kind of the final straw that broke the camel's back occurred. And I think that we're going to be seeing, I know in the work that we do, in my office and in my programs, changes in the messaging that we use. And I know that there are kind of many, many people here in the audience who are working to affect those changes themselves in the work that they do. Just this week, NASTAD, National Association of State and Territorial AIDS Directors, publicly declared their support for this issue and the need to change how we're messaging. And so I think change is coming.
Good. So next we're going to hear from Michelle Durham, the executive director of Beat AIDS Coalition Trust for 23 years. She has served as the chair of the San Antonio AIDS Coalition, the chair of the Region 8 HIV/AIDS Consortium, as a member of the Mayor's HIV/AIDS Commission, and as a chair of the San Antonio HIV Services Planning Council, and is currently an active member of the statewide